Good evening, everyone. This is TakeBack.org. I'm Sheila, and every week we try to bring you interesting topics that are in the news, in politics, in life, and in culture. And today we have a very, very special program. As you know, I'm very involved in the power of purple, in the fight against domestic violence in our community, and we have a very powerful institution that's been here for 40 years now that is protecting men, women, and children in our culture, in our community, from domestic violence, rape, sexual assault, and all of the ramifications of family violence that occur in our society and that are still deeply felt and here and need to be fought. So we have with us three people who are intimately involved in the history of this great organization, which started out as the Women's Center of Southeastern Connecticut in 1976 and has now been around for 40 years, now changing its name to Safe Futures to represent everyone. And I want to go back and talk about the history of this fabulous organization, why it got started, how it got started, what has happened over the years and the changes and what we need to do today. So we have three great guests. I want to introduce first Laura Mooney, who is the president of the board of Safe Futures.
Good evening.
Good evening, Laura. Nice to see you. How long have you been the president of the board of Safe Futures?
I've been president now for about 4 years. I originally was a joint president with two other girls, and then on my own for the last 2 years.
And in a brief summary, just tell everybody why you got involved in this organization.
Well, I got involved because I had a friend from college who had been a victim of domestic violence. And I think that's actually one of the most extraordinary things about our board of directors, and that everybody has had their lives touched by domestic violence in some ways. But for my own personal experience, it was back in actually in the 1970s, 40 years ago, when I was in college. My close friend was getting married, and she was having problems with the relationship before they even got married. But after a while, he started to be very abusive. And in those days, there was nowhere for you to go. Nobody talked about domestic violence. We tried going to the police, and they refused to get involved because there was no signs of physical abuse. And there was no safe house. And so we all had to gather around, and we had to shelter her ourselves. We would pass her around from family member to cousin to friend, and so she was in hiding for about 2 months. And memories of that have stayed with me forever. I have a family of four children. I have a wonderful husband, and I consider myself very fortunate. But the horror of what she experienced and how there was nothing available for her stuck with me, and it relates very much to how this.
And it's so interesting that so many of the people who work for Safe Futures, either as paid employees or as volunteers, have a personal story in their lives, in their families' lives, in their neighbors' lives, and so forth. So let's go on to Kathy Vernano. Kathy is the current executive director of Safe Futures. Tell us how you came to be involved in this organization.
Prior to coming to Safe Futures, the Women's Center, 23 years ago, I was in corporate banking. And a very good friend, very close friend of mine and peer, was brutally murdered by her husband. Mm. And we all used to go out together on Friday nights back then in Hartford. It was a hopping place, and her husband would join us sometimes. They seemed like the greatest couple. Susan was always so full of life, the life of the party, a lot of fun. And I remember being out Friday night, the night before, celebrating her birthday, and Tom stopped by. And the next day, as managers in banking, you had to work one day a month on Saturdays in the office. So I was in the office, and he came through the drive-thru and was taking out money, and we were all teasing him. I hope you're buying Susie a really great present. And he said, yes, I am. And then Sunday, we got a call from the state police that they had someone in custody in Massachusetts stating that he killed his wife in Connecticut. Mm-hmm. And we all got together at the bank. They wanted to meet us. And we learned that he had actually stabbed her 42 times with a pair of scissors Friday night before he even came through the drive-thru. And I remember the state trooper telling us that he stabbed her 42 times with a pair of scissors, and she was in her nightgown. And I still have that image of, unfortunately, that's the image I hold of Susan. So I came to Safe Futures shortly after because I wanted to, I knew I couldn't change the outcome for Susan or even her little sister who was at the funeral begging for her to wake up.
Wow.
But I wanted to make a change for someone else. And it's 23 years ago, I have never looked back.
Wow.
Never.
Okay.
So that's how I came.
And our third guest is Donna Goldman, who was with Women's Center, now Safe Futures, almost at the beginning. As a volunteer, as a staff person. So tell us how you got involved.
Well, in 1978, a year after the Women's Center got started, I was very interested in women's issues. And one of my, at that point, the Women's Center, one night a week, which I had forgotten about, they had a lecture, a topic that they would talk about, and a friend of mine said, "You're always interested in women's issues." I went with her, and then I was sold.
Okay.
The topic probably was displaced homemakers, because that was one of the first things that they did. They worked with homemakers, had a job bank, resume writing. So I was hooked, and I started volunteering. I went on the board, and then I got hired as actually one of the first paid people as a volunteer coordinator.
Okay. So in your experience, sort of like mine, we may not have had a personal experience in our neighborhood or in our family directly, but we were interested in women's empowerment issues. We were part of the women's movement of the 60s and the 70s as we grew up with our families, knowing that we had to make some changes for women in our society.
Right.
And so that impelled you to go.
Right, but I learned so much because looking back, I could see people and I would say to myself, why didn't I see that? Because then, years later, I had a very good friend who also was killed by her husband. And he got away with it for 5 years until they figured it out. You know, he was always a suspect, but they couldn't prove it. And I would say we'd go out with them all the time. Why didn't I see it? Then I noticed the signs. You know, hindsight is 20/20.
Mm. All right, so let's just go back to 76 and talk about, you described it very well, Laura, that in this culture, in 1976, it was very hard to get any help. Women who were abused, and let's clear the air and say we know that men are also victims of domestic violence, that Safe Futures changed its name to make sure that we understand that we service men, women, children, families, and some percentage of all the abuse victims are men. But when we talk about the Women's Center, it did start out as a way to empower women to, as Donna was talking about, get jobs in the workforce, learn how to dress properly, raising women's consciousness issues, displaced homemakers, and things of that nature. It started out that way, and then it gradually progressed to do what, Kathy? How did it change its focus?
It has changed. We have grown so much through the years. Our programs now are, we work very collaboratively with all of our partners to include law enforcement, courts, our coordinated access network for housing. We all have our parts to work together for one victim. So we have one victim, we may be working with Department of Child and Family, law enforcement, a prosecutor, Connecticut Legal Services, homeless housing coordinators, TVCCA, so Southeastern Mental Health. So we now have developed roundtables, community roundtables that we all work together quarterly to discuss how can we all, sometimes it's agree to disagree, or it's educating each other on what our roles are. Years ago, it used to be more we felt we had to do this alone. And we realized we can't do it alone. We need all of our partners to do things
well,
together.
Well, we know that through many community outreach programs, there's more and more education and there's more and more understanding of this issue, even though the statistics still remain horrible. We still know that one out of three women and some men will be abused during their mm-hmm. lifetimes, that our teenage girls and college girls are subject of dating violence and rape in universities. And we know that millions of children are affected by some of them just observing their parents or their mother and significant others have violent episodes in the home, which is just as damaging to their psyches and to their futures as if they themselves were abused. So we know that these statistics are still here and they're still horrible, but at least we know that help is on the way, that there's more education. What were you going to say,
Laura? I was just going to say, I think one of the problems that we have and which we're trying to fight with this 40th anniversary is a real awareness of domestic violence. Yes, we know the statistics, we hear it about it on television, we read it in the paper. But people, I think, like you were both saying, you didn't really register that there was problems going on with close friends of yours. A lot of people, it's still a taboo subject, and I think we still shy away from being really aware that, yes, this could be my next door neighbor or the person at work who suddenly has stopped talking and retreating into a corner, or a child falling asleep at the desk. I think we tend to interpret those symptoms in different ways. And we really need to try and make people more aware that, yes, this does happen in your town, in your family, in your neighborhood, and which is very different from always just looking at the statistics.
Well, true, and we have to realize that the whole culture, the criminal justice system, the courts have changed to take recognition of this so that back in the 70s, if it wasn't recognized that someone could get arrested whether or not the victim said to get them arrested, that it was still an arrestable crime mm-hmm. even if the victim said, don't prosecute.
But years ago, that was not true. Years ago, if the victim said, I'm not pressing charges, and there were various reasons for that, lack of support, the shame, and she still loved him.
And that whole process made it even more difficult, compounded the difficulties in a person wanting to come forward, knowing that she or he would be grilled mercilessly, would be undercut in their veracity, and would not necessarily have the supports. And then we also know, as we've learned, that once someone develops the courage to leave, try to leave a situation, that's when it's the most dangerous. That's when there's more violence and more murder. So that there are so many psychological dynamics that we've grown to be aware of, and how to fight it is very, very difficult. But I want to talk about all the services that we started to get, because in the 1970s, there was a very famous case in the 80s in Connecticut, the Tracy Thurman case, that really lit the way for Connecticut being a pioneer in starting the restraining order movement and the whole criminal justice reform movement about how police should react to these domestic violence situations. And so we're the benefit of that history. So let's start with a woman. Let's take a woman or man who is in an emergency situation right now and calls the hotline. First of all, tell us, what is the hotline number?
It's 860-701-6000.
Okay, everybody should know that number.
Yes.
That's
yes.
a number that should be yes. on your lips as a friend, as a helpmate of someone who you assume or think might be in trouble and might need help. So they call the hotline and they're in an emergency situation. Take us through the steps. Take that person from the beginning terror of the fear of violence against them and maybe their children, maybe their pets, as we know. Let's start and go through the system as we progress.
Okay. So I will mention one thing that I'm not sure if you're aware of, but we are also partnered with all of our local law enforcement in Southeastern Connecticut to include tribal, municipal, and state police on what's called the Lethality Assessment Program. We call it LAP. So an officer on the scene of a crime, if someone screens in as being at high risk of being murdered, they're calling we have a designated line just for them. They're calling us right from the scene and putting the victim on the phone.
Right.
So this high-risk victim is immediately connected to us to talk about this immediate safety plan. We'll get you into a shelter. We'll get you into, or a safe place that you want to be at
okay.
if you don't want
to
come into shelter.
Okay, so let's take one step at a time.
Yeah.
if you need emergency assistance, we have a facility. It's a safe house. Nobody knows where it is.
Correct.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And that is the first refuge that that person, and can that person bring his or her family with them to the safe house?
Yes. Other than the abuser, yes.
All right. And
whatever age the children are.
All right.
Yeah.
And so when we visit Safe Futures at 16 J Street in New London, Connecticut, we're not, that's the administrative building,
right.
And then next door there's a
transitional living
facility,
program.
Which we'll talk about,
yes.
But that's not where
no.
the safe house is, so we have to make that clear.
I'd like to add
yes.
something. One of the other things that Safe Future has been doing once the domestic violence program started is that a woman can call, not be ready to leave yet, because sometimes it
Very
takes
important.
A woman so many times, 5, 6
right.
times to leave and come back. A counselor will talk with her in person, on the phone, all anonymously, to show her and teach her how to prepare for leaving.
How to have a safety plan.
Have a safety plan. Like get your license, some money, things you need.
That's an excellent point. So you don't have to call in the heat of that emergency, although
Correct.
It's important to call. But if you're thinking about it, if you haven't yet developed the final decision, but you know something's not right and you need help, you can reach out and develop a safety plan. What happens if I decide to leave?
And
where
I
do I go? What do I do?
And I think a lot of women who are thinking about leaving will feel more secure about leaving if they have a suitcase packed with their essentials and some money and important paperwork. But of course, they have to hide it.
Yeah, maybe medication.
Right. Let's take the process through. So now there was a lethality assessment through that call. The police were involved. You got the call. Now the person and the family are in.
Maybe 2 o'clock in the morning, we transport them right to our shelter.
They're right in the shelter.
We bring them in.
All right.
We pay
for transportation. It doesn't have to be lethal, though. A woman could call on her
Absolutely.
Own.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Absolutely.
But this is another added feature that we're working with because we know that
because
the
many,
danger is,
right,
is there.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
So now that person might need some court attendance, right? There may be a criminal protective order. There may be a restraint. We know that. Back in the 80s, Connecticut was a pioneer in restraining order statutes that enable people to get emergency orders to have the abuser leave the home on an emergency basis and then have a hearing on it later. And we've, over the years, expanded and improved on the way that we handle those restraining orders. But then there might be the criminal court where there is a protective order that the victim gets against the perpetrator. What help do we get? What does
the
Safe Futures do for that?
So that same victim who the police connected to our hotline the night before and is now in our shelter is ready to work with our family violence victim advocate right in court. We are contracted in court. We have our own office in court. And we can do a protective order right over the phone. The victim does not have to come to court the next morning and face their abuser. That victim advocate in court is there for the full time of the case, from start to finish. They are in multidisciplinary meetings with prosecutors, family relations officers, probation officers on a weekly basis for high-risk cases, repeat offenders. So we're there to walk that victim through the court system to understand their rights, and sometimes it goes right up to the trial. Many times in court cases, 37% of the criminal court cases in southeastern Connecticut are domestic violence. So what that means is it's a very busy docket. So we have our own specialized domestic violence prosecutor. They meet weekly as a team. And some families do not want to separate. So what's the best resolution there? Maybe getting counseling for the offenders involved. Probation is a part of the meeting. Looking at their history. DCF may be a part of the meeting. So it's helping to understand what the family really needs. Maybe it's substance abuse treatment, many different classes that a judge can order someone to be in, anywhere from 9 week to 26 weeks to 52 week sessions. And in the meantime, Safe Futures is working with that victim while the courts or programs are working with the offender.
Exactly. And then at some point, if that person that is in the shelter needs to move on with life, they're working through the court system, they can go into the transitional living. Tell us about
Absolutely. We have our transitional living program called the Phoenix House. It's right on site, and it is 9 apartments for families coming out of domestic violence shelters or fleeing domestic violence. They can live there up to 2 years. In that 2-year time, they may be working towards education goals. They may be working towards increasing their income so they can sustain once they leave. We also have a scattered site transitional living program now on a different grant, so that victims, we're able to find apartments for them off-site, and then we case manage them for maybe a year and assist them, and then we move on and the victim stays in that apartment. So there's two different types of transitional living programs we offer.
In the early days when you were working as a volunteer, can you give us an anecdote or two of some things that you saw happen and how it helped people's lives in that moment?
Well, it wasn't just when I was a volunteer, because in the early days of the Women's Center, even if you were a paid person, and then I became a counselor, and we all had to take the hotline at some point.
And we still do.
We never went out by ourselves. There was a primary hotline counselor and a secondary. So when you got the call from the person who answered the phone, they would call you, and then you'd call your backup, and the two of you would meet somewhere and go out together. We did realize, even at that time, that it could be a dangerous thing. And most of the time it happened, of course, in the middle of the night. And we'd go and meet the person, the woman, sometimes. First we would call her back with our phones blocked, so it wouldn't be on her on the phone.
Yeah.
And we would talk to her on the phone, find out what was going on, her level of danger at that point. If she wanted to leave, it's very hard to, it's impossible to say to someone, you need to leave. You just have to lay out their options. Mm-hmm. And that's also a time when we did safety planning. So if she wanted to leave, we'd meet her in a public place, a police station, a hospital waiting room. We'd call ahead and say, we're meeting this person, and then talk to her. And there were some rules, regulations to come into the shelter. Mm-hmm. She would have to be sober and have and truly need, because it was just, there wasn't room for, I think at that time we could take 10 people, I don't remember.
How many, what capacity is there now, approximately?
Now it's 15, but we also have a reserve room, so we're 116%
and
of
always,
the capacity
and always,
of all
always,
time.
Yeah, okay. Capacity. Yeah.
And there are no rules.
All right. So we would take them to the shelter, we'd have to know, assess, and you can't always be correct, that she will not tell her batterer where she was living.
Exactly.
And what was interesting about it, because occasionally, not very often, but occasionally the woman would decide, oh, I miss him, and let him know where the shelter was. I cannot tell you how many times we evacuated that shelter, and since we had a relationship with all the shelters in the state, we would pack her up and everything and drive her to another shelter until we knew that she was safe.
Okay. So I want to move on as we're getting toward the end of our program. From the history, we see that we've made improvements. The criminal justice system helped us out. But the important thing also I want to have Laura talk about is the education, outreach, and awareness. Bringing in other community organizations like my fund, the Rose Conrad Memorial Fund, which I started when my client was murdered by her husband back in 2005, and then working through that to develop the Power of Purple program, which is an important adjunct of Safe Futures, where we do outreach and awareness for the entire community. And then the work in the schools, the Violence is Preventable program. Talk about that, because we know we take care of the victims, mm-hmm. and we talked about how we do that, but
educating
the community in through education, especially children, and teaching them about healthy relationships. How important is that?
Well, that's essential, because we've discovered that the main way to try and prevent domestic violence is through education and teaching children healthy relationships. And this program developed back in 1992 when they tried to make it less of a crisis center but more preventative approach. And so the program now goes through probably about 20 to 23 schools mm-hmm. and 6 or 7 districts that we have now. We have 5 educators who are all trained counselors, as well as being trained in this program. And we reach out to children from kindergarten through to high school. And one of the important things is healthy relationships. What is a healthy relationship? What boundaries do we need to set up, and what are we comfortable with? What is a safe touch? And how do we feel about this? I had the opportunity to go and witness an 8th grade class in a local school recently. And it was amazing how the children learned that everybody has a different boundary of safety. But what was also important is the fact that now they are so busy with their phones and iPhones and communicating that way, they don't have the same knowledge of facial expressions, how to read facial expressions and lead voices. And so that's an important part of our training now, so that they can learn to read other people's responses. And then when we get into high schools, what is a healthy date and what to do if they don't
feel
safe.
And can you do that? Can you get the children involved in learning about healthy relationships without bringing in the families that they come from? Where that's really the main place that's really where the cycle of violence keeps going on and on and on down through the generations. Wonderful to get those kids involved, but we need to make it a community and family-based thing as well, don't you think?
Well, a lot of women stay with their abusers because of the children. They think that it's more important to keep the family together than leaving and taking the children away, and they do not realize that a child will be healthier if leaving a relationship like that. And if the children are learning about all the safety, they could say to their mother, we have to leave.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Very important. We're going to wrap it up. So, Kathy, I'm going to give you the last word as the director of Safe Futures. We want everybody to know that we're celebrating the 40th anniversary of this wonderful organization, that as much as we have a tremendous amount of progress to still make in our culture, we still have gender equality issues, we still have horrific statistics of violence. This organization has been doing fantastic work for these 40 years and will continue. Tell us why it's important to support this organization and to learn about it.
I think, as Laura said, and as everyone has said, that we're still facing 14 intimate partner homicides a year in the state of Connecticut. And we have to make it easier for our women to leave, and men and children, and have the resources out there for when they leave and how to continue their life after. The struggles of working as a single parent, being the sole provider, being responsible for that children, and to get them to school, to get them to practice, to get them to every social event is very challenging. And it's hard. It's hard for them to maintain their positions, their jobs, and keep up a social life. Okay. So I think we really need to focus more on the victim after they leave.
Right. So give us the website is www.safefuturesct.org, and you can go online and learn all about it. And let's do that hotline number one more time, Kathy.
860-701-6000.
Okay. We hope you've learned something today. We'll be back next week with some more interesting things to talk about in our culture, in our community. please go to safefuturesct.org. Learn about this important organization. Learn about your role in it as a citizen, as a family member. Good night. We'll see you next week. Thank you.